welcome to the preaching teaching ministry of Berean Bible Church here in Denver. Today is Palm Sunday. Happy Palm Sunday to you. Next week, we'll be celebrating our Lord's resurrection. I just wanted to take a moment to just ask you to take a moment to say thank you to the Lord today for all the physicality that went into this death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. He was incarnated, came physically. The cross, it was all physical, resurrection, physical, all these different things that happened. And we just want to take a moment out to say thank you, because it had to be done that way. And we're grateful that the Lord Jesus Christ was willing to do it that way as well. We're continuing right now in the book of Galatians. As you know, we're in Galatians chapter 2. Today we'll be focusing on verses 17 through 19. To show you how relevant the book of Galatians is to your life, I was at a gathering yesterday and a lady had come up and talked to me about some struggles and challenges she was having in her church. It was about law keeping and food laws. It was about basically the very same things that we're studying here in Galatians. We are calling them Judaizers. They were coming against Paul's gospel and they were putting people under the Mosaic law. Well, this lady is in right here with us, and this was what was going on in her church. So I encouraged her to join us and start studying the book of Galatians. I think it will be a blessing to her. Hope it's been a blessing to you, because we really are dealing with a lot of the same things that the Galatians were dealing with. So with that, let's go on and have a word of prayer. Let's get started. Let's pray. Father, we want to thank you again for this time together. Thank you for the privilege of being able to come and study the book of Galatians. And Father, we just pray and ask that your Holy Spirit would really have his way today. Some of the material we're covering can be difficult to understand. And we're just asking him, as the teacher and the writer of Scripture, to help us understand, Father. We pray that we would be filled with the Spirit and that he would have his way in our life as a teacher and as those who would be listening. So thank you again for what you're able to do, Lord, above and beyond anything that we could ever ask or think. And we sure trust you to do that. So thank you, Lord. We look forward with excitement to what you're going to do. And we place this all in your hands. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we always do, we're going to start with a scripture reading, and we're going to be looking at Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 through verse 21. Now, I want you to really concentrate as we're looking at verses 11 through 14, because I'm not going to say very much about that in review. So pay real close attention, if you would, and we're going to read verse 11 on to verse 21. So let's go ahead and do that now. Galatians chapter 2, starting at verse 11. But when Cephas came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood condemned. For prior to the coming of certain men from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But when they came, he began to withdraw and hold himself aloof, fearing the party of the circumcision. The rest of the Jews joined him in hypocrisy, with the result that even Barnabas was carried away by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas in the presence of all, if you, being a Jew, live like the Gentiles and not like the Jews, how is it that you compel the Gentiles to live like Jews? We are Jews by nature, not sinners from among the Gentiles. Nevertheless, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Christ Jesus, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law. Since by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified. Here's our new verses. But if while seeking to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have also been found sinners, is Christ then a minister of sin? May it never be. For if I rebuild what I have once destroyed, I prove myself to be a transgressor. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself up for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if righteousness comes through the law, then Christ died needlessly. Well, there's our scripture reading for today, Galatians chapter 2, verses 11 through 21. Our sermon title today is Objections and Realities. Objections and Realities. And we're basically going to study verses 17 through 19. So with that in mind, let's go back to verse 15. If you'll allow me to read it, I will. It says, "We are Jews by nature and not sinners from among the Gentiles." So last week we summed this up, that basically Paul is talking to Peter and other Jews there, and he talks about the advantages that the Jewish people had, some advantages because they were God's chosen people to represent him in the earth. And the bottom line on verse 15 is that he was basically saying to Peter, "Peter, we know who we are. We know who we are. We know where we come from. And we're not Gentile sinners like the rest of the world. We're not in the category of the other people that were not called out as God's special people." So then we got into verse 16, and we talked to you about the fact that this book is about what's called justification, or being declared righteous, being made all right with God, is how I'd like to say it. And so this book is about that. And the first time the word is used is here in verse 16, and I read it. "Nevertheless, knowing that a man is not justified by the works of the law, but through faith in Christ Jesus, even we have believed in Christ Jesus, so that we may be justified by faith in Christ and not by the works of the law, since by the works of the law, no flesh will be justified." Probably one of the most important verses in this whole book of Galatians. And the bottom line is, it doesn't matter if you're a Jew or a Gentile. It doesn't matter if you had the history that Peter and Paul, had with God. It doesn't matter where you come from, the color of your skin. Nothing matters but this, that your faith is in Jesus Christ. Your faith is in what he did, in his faithfulness, as it concerns how a person is saved today. The bottom line is, there is not anyone on this planet who is going to be saved any other way than faith in Christ based on the faithfulness of Christ. And so in verse 16, it's basically summarized this way. Paul is telling Peter, "We got the memo. We got the memo. It's faith in Christ or nothing at all. It's all about Jesus." So we go on now to verse 17, and this is our new material. And as I get into this, I want to explain to you that verses 17 through 18, and maybe a little bit of verse 19, are very hard to understand scriptures, okay? They're a real challenge. They're difficult to understand. And so I just want you to know that and make sure you have that before we even get started. So let's go into verse 17, our new material. "But if while seeking to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have also been found sinners, is Christ then a minister of sin? May it never be." So as we look at this, and as you just kind of look at it and try to figure out what is it saying? Basically, Paul is still talking to Peter in verse 17, and he's saying that we Jewish people, we did something. We sought to be justified. We sought to get in right relationship with Jesus Christ. We got the memo, and we found out that we too are justified the same way as everybody else by faith in Christ, based on the faithfulness of Christ. And so he's saying, and part of what we found out as we learned this information is that we are sinners. We are sinners just like everybody else. We are sinners. And so if that's the case, is Christ then a minister of sin? And you're going, no, there's no way. It seems like the verse is asking, if we're justified and we believe we are and it comes through Christ, then he asks the question, is Christ then a minister of sin? Well, absolutely not. We found out we were sinners when we came to Christ. It's quite complicated. In some ways, it kind of makes us scratch our head for a second there. As I looked at commentators and read some different things, I came up with something that really seemed like it made sense, that there's a possibility here that Paul is not only stating the facts about Jews and Gentiles or Jews becoming sinners, which they are, and that whole piece, but he's also saying something a little different. Maybe someone was coming at them or attacking him and his ministry a different way. And so I want to read a commentary on it that I think is pretty good. It comes from Kenneth Wiest, and it's a commentary on verse 17. Listen very closely. It says this: "The Judaizers argued that in view of the fact that violation of the law is sin, Therefore, abandonment of the law in an effort to be justified in Christ is also sin. Thus, Christ is also the promoter of sin. Let me read that one more time. The Judaizers argued that in view of the fact that violation of the law is sin, therefore abandonment of the law in an effort to be justified in Christ is also sin. Thus, Christ is also the promoter of sin. Hope you understood that. It does make some sense. They were basically saying, and what Paul is possibly saying is this, that there were people who were coming with this accusation, and they came to this conclusion. They were thinking, if it's a sin to disobey the law, and it would be, and it is, if you disobey, if you blow it on one point, you've blown the whole law. So if it's a sin to disobey the law, and Paul is teaching that you're going to toss the whole law out to be justified, that you can't fall back on the law at all to be justified or declared righteous, to be all right with God, to be saved, that you can't rely on the law at all, and you're casting the law completely to the side, well, that's a whole lot of sinning going on. If it's a sin to mess up one point and you're taking the whole thing and tossing it, it's got to be sin all over the place. And if that's the case, Jesus is responsible for this because the law is not there, okay? And so that's what they're basically saying. And there seems to make some sense. That seems to make some sense. And so Paul answered them, may it never be, God forbid, we might even say perish the thought, okay? Perish the thought. So then we go into verse 18 and it says, for if I rebuild what I have once destroyed, I prove myself to be a transgressor. And so that is kind of hard to understand as well, because basically what it's communicating is there was something in place and then I tore it down, so to speak, and now I'm building it back up again. That's what it seems to communicate, but it's a little deeper than that. I have a thought here and I want to read this thought to you. It was right to abandon the law to be justified, Peter. It is wrong to go back to it. That seems to be what's being communicated, that it was right for Peter to leave the law. Remember, this is all about Peter and him changing his treating of the Gentiles. He started to treat them and separate himself and went back to something we used to say old school, separate but equal. He went back to that, and that was wrong, and that was a sin. And so Paul is kind of communicating in verse 18, it's right to abandon the law. It's right to give it up. We saw that in verse 16. So it couldn't be right to go back to it. It's wrong to go back to it. So then we go into verse 19, and verse 19 starts with an explanatory four. Here's why it would be wrong to go back to it. And it says in verse 19, for through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. So verse 19 is communicating that the believer, Paul specifically, has died to the law, okay? He's died to the law, and it was through the law that he died to the law. Boy, that sounds like a whole mouthful, doesn't it? So as we get into these verses here, we go back and we kind of look at some things there, and we have our little summary sentences that in verse 19, I died to the law, through the law, and the result will be that I could live for God. Something positive happens. There's fruit for God because I died to the law. So you want to really make sure you get that and hold on to it. Dying to the law means fruit for God. That's a good thing, okay? And then we talked about in verse 18, backing up just a little bit, that it was good that the law was put aside in that sense. And so to go back to it, to try to rebuild it, that's not the right thing to do. That would be the wrong thing to do. And then verse 17 was talking about the whole thing of, the law comes in. We were found sinners. And if it was a sin to break one point in the law, surely it must be a sin to break all the law or put the law aside. So as we get into this, I think that we're going to come at this a little different way today. I think we can answer verse 17, verse 18, and verse 19 if we look into what our Bibles call our identification with Christ. More specifically, our identification with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. So stay with me, because all of these things will get answered here. As we begin talking about our identification with Christ in his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, We go to 1 Corinthians 12:13. In 1 Corinthians 12:13, we see that we were baptized or placed into the body. We were baptized or placed into the body of Christ the moment that we received Christ as our Savior, the moment we placed our faith in Christ as a person and placed our faith in Christ and his faithfulness in his finished work, which is the death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. At that very moment, the Holy Spirit placed us or baptized us into the body of Christ. As we study that further, we go over to Romans chapter 6, and it gets a little bit deeper. We get into Romans chapter 6, and we see that we not only were placed into the body of Christ, we were also placed into Christ. We were placed into Christ, and we were even more specifically, as we study Romans chapter 6, we were placed into his death, his burial, his resurrection, and his ascension. We were placed in all of that. We were even placed into his seating, according to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. This is all called identification truth, or our union with Christ again in his death, burial, and resurrection. So once again, we were placed into the body, and then we were placed into Christ's very life, and we were placed into the things that Jesus Christ did. Now, you know this, but let me refresh your memory. That was very beneficial. There are some things that bother us. There are some things that hinder us from being all that God would have us to be. One of those is our old man, who we used to be before we got saved. Romans 6:6 says our old man was crucified through our union with Christ. Another thing that hinders us is sin, which is still in these bodies. Romans 6:6 also says that sin was rendered inoperative in our lives through our union with Christ. We then move on to what's called the flesh, how I get my needs met, how I get through the day, leaving Christ out. In Galatians 5:24, we're told that our flesh was crucified as well. That was taken care of. That was another problem area that was taken care of in our union with Christ. We also have the world that pulls at us and hinders us in our walk with Christ, hinders us from being all that God would have us to be. Galatians 6:14 says we were crucified to the world and the world was crucified to us as well. So that was hindered through our union with Christ as well. Then as we continue on, we see that we get into the word and it talks about we were crucified to the law, or we died to the law. When we get into we died with Christ, we're talking about that old man or the old self. And when we were resurrected, it was a new person. You remember 2 Corinthians 5:17, if anyone be in Christ, he is a new creation. Behold, the old things have passed away. Behold, all things have become new. We become a new person as part of our union with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. The new person that we are now has been joined to Christ, has been joined to Christ. And in that joining to Christ, it says we now have the potential to really produce fruit for God, to really produce fruit for God. So we're talking about dying to the law and being more profitable for God, so to speak. Well, that happens because the new person we are is joined to Christ, and we're now able to produce more fruit for God. And then Romans chapter 7, verse 4, through the body of Christ, we died to the law. That's a fact, okay, that we died to the law through the body of Christ. The moment you got saved, you got placed into the body of Christ, and the moment that you got placed into the body of Christ, you die to the law as well. And Romans 7:6 talks about this, and this is really important, that there's a new way of doing things that God has in place now. It's not about trying to keep the rules and regulations of the law. It's not about trying to be moral in that sense of coming into relationship with God. It's not about being religious, doing things to please God, hoping he's pleased. No, this thing is about a relationship. God is reaching down to us in relationship. And Romans 7:6 says this, there's a new way of doing things right now, and it's by the Spirit, or it's according to the Spirit. It's not about rules and regulations and trying to keep things and not do this and do that. It's about being led by the Spirit. It's about the Spirit having his way in our lives. It's a whole new way that God wants us to live as Christians now, and it's being led by the Spirit, according to the word of God, okay? According to the word of God. And that's how this thing is to work. So we're getting back to our illustration in our union with Christ. We die to the law. We talked about that. The scriptures say in Romans 6:14, sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, you are under grace. Because we die to the law, we can live a victorious Christian life. Because we die to the law, we can sin less. Sin shall not have dominion over you. Sin is not going to be your boss, the boss of me no more. Why? Because you died to sin. You're not under law, you're under grace. And grace provides everything that is needed for us to live the type of life that God wants us to live. And so these are things that happen in our union with Christ. Again, in our union with Christ, we died with him on the cross. We were buried with him in the tomb. We rose with him the third day, a new creation in Christ. Okay. Then we ascended with him about 40 days out. Then he was exalted. He was made the head of all things, according to Ephesians chapter 1. Not just the head of the church, the body of Christ. He was made the head of all things. He was given preeminence, the ultimate authority. And part of that authority that he was given, he was made the head of the church, the body of Christ. And he sat down in this place of exaltation and honor at God's right hand. And Ephesians 2:6 says, you and I are sitting there right now, present tense, at God's right hand, in him, in Christ, at God's right hand. And that's where we are. We have all of these blessings because we are in Christ and Christ is in us. And so those are some of the things that we're talking about here about our union with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. And then 2 Corinthians chapter 5 teaches that we are in a temporary stay here on the planet as an ambassador. We're ambassadors, that's our job title, temporary stay, a sojourning here on the planet. And we are we have a message of reconciliation, very specifically, that God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them. This is all part of our union with Christ, our identity with Christ, who we really are. And what God is wanting from us is for us to find out what these facts are, to believe them, to receive them, to appropriate them, and trust him to make these things real in our experience. This is how God is operating today. This is what he's doing. As we talk about the Holy Spirit, we can't focus on him enough in a sense, because as we get into the word, we see that from Galatians chapter 5, verse 22, he brings the fruit of the Spirit into our lives as compared to us trying to produce something through the law. He brings the love, the joy, the peace, the faithfulness, the gentleness, the self-control, all of the fruit of the Spirit, God the Holy Spirit brings into our life as our birthright, and it's not about keeping the law. That's in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. Then we go over to Ephesians 5:18. It talks about being filled or controlled by the Spirit. That's very important. That's what God is doing today in our lives as compared to us trying to keep the law, and we don't have the strength to do that. And then we continue on with this thing over in Galatians. It talks about us really living by the Spirit. And it says, if you have the Spirit in your life, you have life by the Spirit, and then we are to live by that power of the Spirit. And that's our birthright as well. It's all about the Spirit. Again, I reminded us earlier that Romans chapter 7, verse 6 is saying God is doing a new thing. It's not about law keeping. It's about being led by the Spirit. It's about communicating with the Spirit, cooperating with the Spirit. It's about following the Holy Spirit. It's about yielding to the Spirit. And when called upon, submitting to the Spirit and obeying the Spirit. This is what is called the normal Christian life. This is what God is doing today at this time in which we live in the church, the body of Christ. And then, as you know, we have even more than that. Galatians 2:20 says this, I have been crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. And the life which I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. So not only do we have the Holy Spirit in our lives, we have God the Son in our life being faithful to live out his life through us as well, as compared to what? Trying to keep the law, trying to be justified by the law, trying to go on with God under the law. No, we have all of these things that God the Holy Spirit and then God the Son brings to the table. With that, the Bible then tells us over in Philippians 2:12, to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. That when we know this, this needs to bring some responses. It doesn't say go get under the law, but as we work out our salvation by faith, the number one thing that we are to do is literally to labor to rest in what God has said. We are to live by faith, Romans 1:17. If you've been justified, you're to live by faith. And as you know, that's three times in the New Testament that particular phrase is used. Three, the number of a validation that those who have been justified are to live by faith, standing on God's word. We are to live by faith and not by sight, 2 Corinthians 5:7. It's not about experiences or how we feel, but standing on what God has said in his word. We are also to further the administration, which is by faith. We get that from 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 3 and 4. We are to be about furthering an understanding, furthering what God is doing today. And what is that? He's calling us to live by faith. We're supposed to be about doing that. Those are some of the things that we are to be about. So as we're working out our salvation, that's what we're supposed to be doing. We also need to understand fully the gospel of the grace of God and understand that we're under an economy. We're under a time of grace, and we need to understand that fully. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 2, Paul talks about being a steward of an economy. He even uses this word dispensation. He says, I'm a steward. I'm the boss over that. And what is it? The economy or the dispensation of the grace of God. We are to fully understand that. Over in Philippians chapter 4, verse 9, he actually says, hey, the things that I did, the things you saw me do, the things you heard about from me, do these things and the God of peace will be with you. We need to be very familiar with the steward who's over this different, this time of grace and living by faith as well. So then we move on and we get that whole thing about living out our faith and with fear and trembling in Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. In the very next verse, he goes on to say, and the reason you do that is because here's another piece that comes into it. It is God who works in you both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So God is actually working in our lives, giving us the desire, and then turning around and doing it through us. This is all what it means. This is all of the things that are coming into it. And I shouldn't say all, there's still more. But this is a big picture of what it means to be dead to the law. This is what it means to be a part of the church, the body of Christ. This is what it means to be in Christ. This is what it means to appropriate your union with Christ in his death, burial, and resurrection. All of these things are a part of that. So as we get back into our text, as we close out today, that's what it means. That's how we die to the law, verse 19. That's how we die to the law, through our union with Christ in his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension. That is why we can live to God, as it says there in verse 19, because of our union with Christ. That is why justification by faith is what is needed, because all of these things come to the person who has been justified by faith and not by works of the law. This is their birthright. This is why this works. This is why justification by faith works for growth. God has put everything in place, including himself, to take us on. It's not about law keeping. It's not about rules and regulations. It's not about being religious. It's about appropriating all that we have in Christ and all that God has given us. Being saved by grace through faith works in this whole Christian life from the beginning to the end. Let me say that again. Being saved, being justified by grace through faith works in this whole Christian life from the very beginning to the end. May we truly grow in grace and in our knowledge of God. That is so important. I hope you see how important it is, because we have a tendency to grow in law, to grow in legalism, to grow in rules and regulations, and to grow in being religious. May we truly grow in grace and in our knowledge of him. And may we continue to grow in grace. Oh, sin may abound, but grace is so much better. Romans chapter 6, verse 1 opens up this way. It says, may we continue to sin that grace may abound? Oh, that's kind of made people question for a lot of years. But if you really understand who you are in Christ, You understand that you could make a choice to sin because grace will always be there. But no, he says, God forbid, God forbid. And then he goes on to ask the question, don't you know who you are? He goes on to ask the question, don't you know what happened when you were placed into the body? He's basically asking the question, don't you know what happened when you died with Christ, buried with him, resurrected, ascended, and sat down with him in the heavenly places? Don't you know what happened? You don't have to sin. You would make a choice to sin. You've been given victory. This is the abundant life. This is the overcoming life. This is the normal Christian life. Oh yeah, it's about grace. It's about God. It's about the triune God living in you. It's about your union with Christ and all that happened there at Calvary. Do you really understand what happened at Calvary? Do you really understand when you were placed in Christ? And if you do, you're asking the wrong question. You're asking the wrong question. And so I just hope and pray that this was just a little spur, a little tidbit to get you to really think, to get that brain going, to really understand how important your union with Christ is and why in verse 19 here, he says, don't you know, through the law, we died to the law so that we might live to God, so that we might really go on. Yes, you died, buried, rose again, and ascended with the Lord Jesus Christ. You are in him, and everything that you'll ever need has been supplied so that you can have a victorious Christian life. That's me and you, but we need to appropriate it by faith and trust God to make it real in our experience. I want to leave you with a poem today, one you've probably heard before, but it's also a summary sentence of everything that we went over today. Here's our poem. The poet says, do this and live, the law commands, but gives me neither feet or hands. A better word the gospel brings. It bids me fly and gives me wings. God meant for you to fly. He meant for me to fly as well. If we're not flying, let's start flying. Let's believe what God says and take him at his word. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for this time in your word. And Father, as we said at the beginning, verses 17 and 18 or 19, they're deep. But Father, we just want to thank you that getting pulled out from under the law and put in Christ and put into the body and put into our identification with Christ is the best thing that could have ever happened to us. And Father, we thank you that we understand that, and help us to understand it more deeply. Oh no, it's not about sinning. This is how you become free from it and walk in victory. And Father, may your name ever be brought up in the same conversation as doing something that would be sinful. And Father, please forgive us where sometimes we go back and try to rebuild what's been torn down. We try to put ourselves back under the old system of law. And Lord, that's not what we're supposed to do. You're doing a new and great thing through the body, through grace, through our union with Christ. Help us, Lord, not go back and try to rebuild that, but to get over here and get in here fully and deeply and experience everything that you have for us as members of your body. And Father, I hope and pray that we understand a little bit better today what it means to die to the law. We literally die to it, and sin shall not have dominion over us, for we are not under law, but under grace. We die to law because there's a new system in place, living by the system of God the Holy Spirit, God the Son, and God the Father, living out this Christian life through us. Father, may we truly experience that. So thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you, you've given us everything that we need to fly, and may we truly fly. Thank you for all that you have done. To God be the glory. May we truly say as Paul did, may I never brag about anything but glory in the cross and in Christ crucified, and a step further, and us crucified with him. Thank you again for everything. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Well, that concludes for today. You have a great week. Good Lord willing, we'll see you next week. Take care of yourself.